Welcome to the Word of the Lord, the weekly television broadcast of Living Word Christian Church, proclaiming the good news of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Pastor Mark Clements, in-depth, relevant biblical teachings will help you in life and living in today's world. Now, let's join Pastor Clements in the service already in progress.
I take the opportunity to answer questions that have been presented to me. And this one came in a number of weeks ago, and 2 weeks ago, December, no? Yeah, 2 weeks ago, this one came in. And it's about offense. How many of you have heard some teaching, some level of instruction you have on the subject of offense? Now, all right, most of you, most everybody. If not, it's one of those subjects, it's one of those topics in the Bible that you can find Old Testament and New. There are warnings, there are admonitions, and it's universal. I like to answer questions that are universal in nature, that are from the Bible. I find in the Gospels that a lot of Jesus' teaching came from questions. People would ask him a question, and he would answer, and that's what we have as Scripture. One of my favorite and classic illustrations of that is found in Matthew 24 and Matthew 25, which all came as a result of one question from one of his disciples that was, "What shall the signs of the end be?" Now, Jesus didn't teach every time he got a question. And so tonight I'm teaching on offense. And so if you ask a question and it didn't get answered publicly, don't take offense. Jesus was questioned quite frequently by the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the doctors of the law and the religious leaders of the day. I still have my share of that, or those who try to be. That doesn't mean I just like Jesus. He didn't answer everything publicly. Sometimes he answered them privately. Sometimes he got together with his closest followers, his inner circle, and he gave the answer to them and didn't teach on it publicly. Sometimes his disciples would ask him, "Why didn't you answer that?" And he would go ahead and answer them. So there's not just an exact pattern of, well, you know, I ask a question. No, I pray about every single one of the questions that I receive, and then I determine a response. So in this one, the Lord's continued to nudge me to go ahead and share a response to this tonight. Good afternoon. You have previously preached on offense and how you shouldn't get offended because it cuts you off from what God has for you. I'll plead guilty. I said I'll plead guilty. Now, I might as well go ahead and just make one other statement, and that is that some of the questions that I receive aren't biblical in nature. In other words, the Bible doesn't have anything to say about it. Now, if the Bible doesn't have anything to say about it, I'm not going to take time up here to address it. Not when the Bible tells me to preach the Word. My job as your pastor is not answer your questions. My job as your pastor is to perfect and equip and disciple you, make you a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, not clear everything up that you're in the fog about. All right, you previously preached on offense. We're going to teach on this tonight because, number one, it's in the Bible. Number two, it's universal, and it is a potential pitfall. You can write that down or you can quote me on that. It is a potential pitfall for every human to be caught up in offense, to be offended. And it does cut you off for what God has for you. I'll definitely take credit for making that statement or plead guilty, one or the other. My question is, how do you know when you're in offense? I think that's a great question. How do you know when you've been offended? How do you know when you're in offense? And I think that's a better way to say it. How do you know when you're in offense? That's a better way to say how do you know when you've been offended? Been offended means past tense. In offense means the effect of it is actually impacting you currently, which it does. How do you know when you're in offense? And once you realize you're in offense, how do you get out? That's a two-part question, and it's a great question. And I answered that and said, great question. I'll be answering it from the pulpit. All right. Let me make this just really crystal clear. This is a really easy answer, but I'm not going to just give you an easy answer. I'm going to teach a little bit on it. The first part of the question is, how do you know when you're in offense? Here's the answer. Most of the time, you don't. It's one of those areas in life that most of the time, you are the only one who's oblivious. Not all the time. You may be sensitive enough to the Holy Spirit who is attempting to help you and assist you and get you out of that, and there may be a stirring and a nagging within you that this isn't right. The amount of teaching, how many of you have sat under Bible teaching for 5 years or more? How many of you have sat under Bible teaching for 10 years or more? How many of you have sat under Bible teaching for a year or more? I mean, if your hands was up already, that'd be okay. 2 years or more. All right, 20 years or more. Big difference, isn't there? 30 years or more. How many of you have been a Christian studying your Bible, reading it, and been sitting under Bible teaching for 50 years or more? There's a big difference. And the more you have sat under guided directorship, anointed, directive, discipling, equipping, maturing, perfecting, teaching from God's Word, the more that will come back and arrest you when you get out of God's will. Because you're critical, because you're judgmental, because your feelings got hurt, because someone wronged you, because you yourself have committed a sin. The Bible, replete throughout the New Testament, says that Christianity is a process of growth. And it's very difficult for a 2 or 3 year old to know what they've done wrong until they're developed, until they're disciplined, until they learn. But they can't say the same thing at 23 that they could say at 3 and just say, well, I didn't know that was wrong. The Holy Spirit, the Bible says in 1 John, bears witness with our spirit. And he can bear witness with your spirit of right, and he can bear witness in your spirit that you're treating people wrong, that what you're doing is wrong. Well, how would I know that? Because it's contrary to God's Word. If you don't know God's Word, you have no possible hope of knowing what's right and what's wrong, what's acceptable, what's unacceptable, what's proper, what's improper in the sight of God. No possible way of knowing. So learn your Bible. Learn it inside and out. Don't ever get tired of reading it, studying it, memorizing it, meditating it. Don't ever get tired of feeding on the Word of God. Nowhere do we read, grow in grace until you reach some certain point. It just says continue to go on, continue to grow, continue to be perfected, and continue to be developed as a Christian to work in ministry. All right, you got so quiet there, I'm going to have to just go over to Ephesians chapter 4. If you brought a Bible, or if you have an electronic version, whatever you have, take your copy of the Bible and open your Bible to Ephesians chapter 4. And it says here, and I shared some of this at our staff meeting here just the other night, that it talks to everybody in the entire body of Christ. Everybody who's a Christian, everybody who's saved, everybody who's born again, everyone who is one of God's children is being addressed in verse 1 and says, you are called. Verse 2 says, be humble, lowliness, meekness, not arrogance, not thinking I know more. Lowliness, meekness, forbearing one another in love. It's talking to the whole body of Christ, the one another verses, endeavoring to keep unity, to keep unity. And then it talks about the oneness in the body, oneness of the Spirit, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, above all, through all, in you all, and unto every one of us. All these verses are the whole body of Christ. Every one of us given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. And he ascended up on high. He gave gifts to men. He gets all the way down to verse 11 before he starts talking about some, S-O-M-E. Now he's not talking about whole body. He's talking about all whole body, verse 11 and verse 12. And verse 11 says, he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastor teachers. That's one word in the Greek. There's no and there. It's pastor slash teacher or pastor dash teacher. It's the same office. And what for? What is the purpose of that pastor teacher? What is the purpose for any of those four gifts? Why do they exist? For the perfecting. Other translations that you may be using say developing, equipping, building up, discipling, maturing, in some other way making ready for work in the ministry and to build up the entire body of Christ. The next verse tells you how long. Until we've learned for a year. No. Until we've learned for 30 years. It doesn't say that. It says till we all come into the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect, that's mature, that's complete, that's I can't grow anymore. That's I can't be developed any further. The perfect man unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ Jesus the Lord himself. Now, I'd like to ask the question right now. Is there anybody in this room beside of me that still has a ways to go before reaching that level? So that means I still have some growth. I still have need of someone in my life to correct me, adjust me. Now let me go back to, here we go. Let's get a pastoral verse. One of them addressed to one of the pastors. I think it's really interesting to both compare to the Bible to the internet preachers who say the day of the pastor is over and we don't need pastors and we're all believers and we're all one under God and those kind of, except for the Bible says that he gave and it does never say he took away and they're going to be there till the whole body comes into unity in the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. There are at least three books of the Bible, Timothy, Titus, and Philemon, that are pastoral epistles, and they're addressed to these young pastors. Timothy needed two letters. Timothy needed a little bit of extra attention. And in 2 Timothy chapter 4, the apostle is exhorting him to do his job as a pastor. Now, in the Amplified version, 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2. I know some of you know this verse because you write it in cards and notes and thank you, Pastor. Please don't quit. Please don't give up. Please don't grow weary in well-doing. Please keep doing what the Bible tells you to do. And then you'll quote this verse. Can I have it? 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2. And this is my job. This is my responsibility. You ought to know it so you don't try to require something of me or expect something of me that isn't biblical. This says, herald and preach the word. Keep your sense of urgency. Stand by and be at hand. Be ready. Whether the opportunity is favorable or unfavorable, whether it's convenient or inconvenient, whether it's welcome or unwelcome, you as the preacher of the word are to show people in what way their lives are wrong. And convince them. We'll get the rest of the verse up here. It's not up there. And convince them, rebuking them, correcting them, warning and urging and encouraging them, being unflagging and inexhaustible in patience and in teaching. Yes. Now, here's a great question if you've never had it posed to you. Where in your Bible does it say you are to show the preacher in what way his life is wrong. Give me one verse. Give me one verse. There isn't one. You don't find one. But if you don't know that, and if you don't do that, then you fall into the way of the entire rest of the world instead of the Bible. And you do something out of God's will, out of God's way, out of God's word, out of the scriptures, and out of order. Yes. All right, just thought I'd share the Bible with you there. Let me help you now in the arena of offense. Now, why did I say all of that? Just to get something off my chest? No, I don't have anything on my chest. Well, my tie, and I'm not going to give that up. I like wearing ties. If you don't like ties, don't wear one. I'm going to. Leave me alone. I remember the first time, I'm just going to talk to you. You look like you're engaged, and you'll enjoy this story. And the first time I got to ever preach, ever, stand in a pulpit, preach a Bible lesson, a Sunday service, and I didn't own a tie. I've got a lot of ties. Right? You ought to be nodding. You gave me most of them. The Christmas ones anyway. A lot of ties. I've given away more ties than I ever will possibly ever own. One time I went to a men's store and they were going out of business and they had 15 suits. They were all too small for the people around here. I was going to Guatemala. I bought all 15 suits. They had 99 ties. I said, take $100, I'll take all 99. I took 99 ties and 15 suits down to Guatemala and gave them out, gave them away. My favorite one I wore the whole time I was there. And there was one girl in this class, and she waited till I was done. I said, you didn't get a tie. She said, I want that one. So, all right. So I took that one off, and I gave that one to her. I was going to preach on a Sunday morning, my very first time, July 1984. Didn't have a tie. Went out and bought a suit, a two-piece suit. Jacket, papers, and I bought my first tie. And then I said, I didn't know how to tie a tie. I've never had a tie in my life. And I remember the person who showed me how, and they put it on and tied it, and they said, there, go ahead and do it. So I caught on real quick. I just gave it back and said, no, you do it one more time, let me watch. And they did it one more time. I said, now don't untie it. And I slipped it off over their head. I've still got it. It's just a good reminder. You don't have to stay where you're at.
That's right.
And you don't have to take and believe that where you're at today is where you're going to end up. Offense. Why'd I say everything I just said? Because of that one principle that her question so aptly brought out when she asked, how do you know when you're in offense? Number one, you very seldom do. Most of the time when you're offended, it takes someone else to point it out to you. Now, who would the obvious person be to point out some error in your life? Everyone only has three classes of people in their life. Their superiors, their peers, and their subordinates. Their superiors, their peers, and their subordinates. Who would the obvious person be in your life to reveal to you and share with you that you're being impacted adversely by being offended? Who would that be? Your subordinates? That wouldn't be in biblical order. Your peers? It would be one of your superiors. So how are you going to receive from your superiors when you're offended at them? Very seldom do you look in the mirror and say, you're offended. It takes someone else to just reveal it, and God's the master of that. The Holy Spirit is just the master. And if he can't get your attention, there's going to be someone that you respect enough that you listen to, that you recognize. That's why it's so important to have a leader. If you go back on our guiding principles as a church, you'll find that one of those 12 guiding principles is leadership, because it is impossible biblically, scripturally, it's impossible spiritually for anyone to successfully navigate a Christian walk and not have a leader or leaders. The Christian church of the Bible is set up so that there is leadership in the church. And those leadership positions are called offices. And there are several of those. And we've taught on those when we teach on church government, we teach on leadership. But you don't find anybody in the Bible that's an island to themselves. You don't find anyone in the Bible that's a lone wolf. You don't find anyone in the Bible that is not somewhere within the structure of godly leadership. And leadership should have my respect and my recognition and my receptivity toward them, so that they can point out something in my life that's wrong. In my case, my pastor, he ought to be able to say anything to me, correct anything in me. And I ought to be smart enough to go to him and say, point out anything in my life that's wrong and mean it. Otherwise, I'll be offended at something, I'll be offended at someone, and then if he points it out, I'll be offended at him. I'll just get offended at him. So very seldom are you ever offended at a subordinate. Nearly impossible to be offended at one of your subordinates. You can be disappointed in them. You can be downright upset with them, but not offended at them. Not often are you offended at a peer. Again, they have no authority in your life. Most often it's with a superior. It's with a leader. It's with someone who's over you. Examples. Greatest example about someone being offended in the Bible is Judas. Judas, who was he offended at? Jesus. Superior, peer, or subordinate? Superior, absolutely, no question. Jesus was his superior, and the Lord Jesus Christ rebuked him publicly. Rebuked him publicly, called him by name. I don't mean just said something that happened to fit. I mean called him by name, rebuked him, corrected him, and he took offense over it, to the point of betrayal. Far more significant than desertion, and far more than denial. He actually betrayed him. He actually took others against him. Judas and Jesus, all right? Some others in the Bible. In Matthew chapter 13, Jesus began teaching people, and they were astounded at his teaching. This was in his hometown. They were astounded at his teaching, but then started to look at the natural aspects of his life and said, he's a carpenter's son, we know his sisters and brothers, and they were offended at him. When you start picking at a person's the natural aspects of their life, and consumed with some of those natural traits, I have a fellow minister of the gospel that before he was a minister, he was a pretty well known member of the Black Panthers. If you don't know what that is, it's a gang, a very violent gang, and he was part of it. And some of the people he associated with went to prison for murder and for robbery and for arson and things of that nature. He pastors a very successful church, has a very successful ministry, and tells in his story, in his account, of one individual that recognized him, and then came to him after service and said, are you the same person that, you know, you used to go to this one university in California? Are you that same person? He said, yeah, that was me. He said, now, if I'm not mistaken, you were part of the Black Panthers. He said, yeah, I was. Well, you were an associate with, and he called a couple of these other names. See, what's happening there? That person's doing exactly the same thing that those people did to Jesus. And he looked at him and said, well, I could never sit under your teaching, and walked out of his church and robbed himself of any miracle, any move of God, any powerful impartation through that ministry gift that God, after he was born again, placed within that man. Placed within that man. Walked away from the miracle-working power of God and possibly the will of God for him to sit under that particular shepherd and be groomed and be educated as a Christian and be perfected and be completed and be matured and walked away from all that because he was offended about some natural aspect of his life. He tells another story about how his wife wore a pink dress to church. And one of the ladies came up and said, "Well, I don't like that pink dress that your wife is wearing." And he smiled and said, "Well, that's okay. She's not wearing it for you. She dresses up nice for me. She's wearing it for me." And that lady said, "Well, I will not go to a church where the pastor's wife wears something like that." And then she left because she got offended at what the pastor's wife dressed in. And then he said, "Then I had to deal with it because I was tempted to be offended with those two individuals and be offended because they brought my pastor and be offended because they didn't like my wife's dress that I bought for her." And then he had to fight offense. And he very honestly and openly talks about that and discusses that and teaches what to do if you're offended, what to do to keep yourself from being offended, and how to live an offense-free life. How'd you like that? How would you like that? Just live a life free of offense. All right? You say, is that even possible, Pastor? Look over with me at Acts chapter 24. Acts chapter 24. Here's a great verse. I'm going to give you two. Acts chapter 24. We're going to give you two. And our second verse will be in the book of Philippians. Acts chapter 24 and verse 16. The apostle writes, "And herein do I exercise myself." Stop right there. Any of you here exercise yourself? You exercise? You have a goal in mind when you do? What's that? What is that goal? Be in better shape, be in better health, have greater stamina. Well, this is what Paul said. He said, "I go through the works and the motions that are necessary." That's what exercise means. "I hereby exercise myself to always..." what word did he use right there?
Always.
"To have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men." It is possible, but you have to exercise yourself. You have to guard yourself. You have to guard your heart. You have to guard your mind. You have to guard your feelings. You have to guard your emotions. You have to take seriously the exercise of protecting yourself from being offended. You can become unoffendable. Amen. No matter what anyone does, no matter what anyone says, no matter how you may be disappointed, it may have the opportunity to offend you, but you don't have to take offense.
That's right.
You do not have to take offense. Offense is something that you take. You can just not take it. You can just reject it. You ever been to a restaurant and they bring you the wrong meal? I sat with a person one time, and they ordered one thing, and the waiter came by, and I received what I ordered, and they put something down, and it wasn't what they ordered. And I brought it to their attention. I said, "You don't have to take that." They said, "Oh, it's okay. It's okay. I'll just go ahead and eat it." I said, "Don't you dare eat that. Send it back." "Oh, I don't want to do that. I don't want to make a scene." I said, "Okay, I'm going to do it for you." And I did. I called the person back, and I said, "They didn't order that. That's not what they ordered. I'm buying and I'm paying for what they ordered. So be real appreciative if you just bring what they ordered." What they ordered. Didn't I do that? Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that. You don't have to take it.
Right.
When offense comes, the opportunity to be offended comes, you don't have to take it.
Amen.
You don't have to take it. Offenses has to be taken. You can live free of offense. Paul said, I exercise myself. I mean, I work at it. I work at it. Now, let's go back to a verse we read a couple of moments ago, Ephesians chapter 4, and look at verse 2 and 3. And it talks about church folk. Because sometimes, believe it or not, the church that you're sitting in right now is not full of all perfect people whose minds have been totally renewed and they're perfected and equipped and they're walking in love to 100% in the utmost. They have peace and joy. There's not even one shred of an ounce of selfishness or self-motivation in them. No, the people of Living Word Christian Church, La Crosse, Wisconsin, they're all perfect. But you may go to a church sometime, just a visit, and there might be an imperfect person there. No, there's not a perfect person in any church anywhere in the world. The only perfect one there is the Holy Spirit, and people even get offended at Him. Might talk about that. So you have to, do I have my verse up here? Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 2. It says, with all lowliness and meekness. That's one way you keep yourself from being offended. You can just jump ahead in your notes if you want. One of the things you have to do is stay humble. One of the things you have to do. Shut them off, please. Everybody's phone's going crazy right now. It's going to say the same thing. Okay? With lowliness and meekness and humility and long-suffering, forbearing one another in love. What's forbearing mean? Putting up with. That's exactly what it means. Tolerating. You have to realize people are imperfect. That's one of the keys to not being offended. Nobody's perfect. Nobody's got everything. Why are you looking at other people and expect everything they do and everything they say and everything they communicate and every decision they made and how they treat everyone else and everything and every aspect of their life to be perfect? You're not. So with lowliness of mind, not high-minded, not arrogant, not prideful, with lowliness of mind, with meekness, with humility, with long suffering. That means putting up with and tolerating a long time, forbearing one another in love. The next word is endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Endeavoring means working hard at it. You have to work hard to have a life free of offense. But that's what the Apostle Paul said. He said, I'm endeavoring. Now, before we read that verse, I wonder, just in the people who are here at this midweek service and just in those of you who are streaming with us, I wonder how many people that I could have approached, say, 90 minutes ago and said to them, are you exercising yourself to have a life free of offense, both toward men and God, both toward God and toward all men? Maybe not. But after this service and then the continuation of this service, because we're going to cut this service a little bit short, after this service and after the continuation of it next week, I wonder then how many that's going to gain some traction in your life. And you're going to start endeavoring and working at keeping yourself free from offense. And do exactly what this apostle said, and that's exercise yourself to have a life free of offense toward God and toward men. Well, how could a person ever get offended at God? We'll come back to that after we answer our question. Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, you may recognize, we've taught for years that there are Bible prayers that you can pray over yourself and over your loved ones, and over anyone else. I've asked you to pray for them over me, and I pray them over you. They're found in Ephesians chapter 1, Ephesians chapter 3, Philippians chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1, Colossians chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, Book of Hebrews. Throughout the New Testament, there are Bible prayers. Bible prayers. One of those is found right here in Philippians chapter 1. And he says, I pray, verse 9, I pray that your love may abound. Your love can abound. Your love can, your love can shrink, your love can stay the way it is, stagnate, or your love can abound. He said, I pray that your love abounds, yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that means understanding. He continues in verse 10, he says, and I pray that you may approve things that are excellent. Now, a real good translation of that verse says that you may make wise decisions in life. Approve things that are excellent. Not make foolish decisions. Not make errant decisions that are going to cost you down the road. But you make wise decisions. That's a prayer. I pray that for you. Pray it for yourself. Pray it for those around you. Please pray it for me. I don't want to make unwise choices. I want to make wise decisions that I don't have to go back and make over again. That's one of those prayers, that you may make wise decisions in life and that you may be sincere and without offense till the day that Jesus Christ returns. I submit to you that it is free to have a life free of offense. Amen. You can be without offense till the day Jesus returns. You don't have to be offended. You don't have to be offended. Now, I'm going to take just a couple more minutes. Is that okay? Yes. All right. If that device of yours is going to keep ringing every 5 minutes, I'd appreciate it if you'd either shut it off or take it outside. I'd just appreciate that. Don't be offended. I shut mine off before I came in here. Okay, all right, what is offense? What is offense? If I'm supposed to exercise myself to keep myself free of it, and I can pray to be sincere and without offense, what is offense? All right, I took a Bible dictionary, and they gave me 7 definitions. What is offense? Number one, offense is a feeling of resentment. A feeling of resentment. And we'll leave it up, and you can, when we're done, turn your device back on, take a picture of it up here. All right? A feeling of resentment. Now, let me ask you again. Could this possibly be because you were corrected? A feeling of resentment because someone corrected you. Well, why do you bring that up, Pastor? Because the most classic example in the Bible of offense is Judas, and he got offended when he was corrected. He was trying to correct the superior officer. Now, don't get hung up on those terms, superior. That just means higher ranking. Doesn't mean more valuable. There's no value level set on human beings in the sight of God. Everyone's of equal and identical value. We all were redeemed by the same price. Just because someone's been walking with the Lord longer than me, you know, I can say I've been walking with the Lord now this coming year. I've been a born again Christian. I've been a child of God. I've been saved for 53 years. Well, I can be around someone else who can say, well, I've been born again for 60 years, so that makes me more important than you. No, there's no importance and there's no value. The same redemptive price was provided for every human being. But in our Bible, because of structure, necessities, there's rank. There's different requirements on those different ranks. It exists in the marriage. It exists in the home and family. It exists in the culture and in society. It exists in the military and any quasi-military structure. It exists in the business world, and it exists in the kingdom of God. And always has. And always will. Always will. It'll never get away from it. And so the example of Judas, of course, is not the only in the Bible. We have Bible verses that say John the Baptist got offended at Jesus. All right? Peers? Or was one subordinate and one superior? Let's see. One is Savior and one is not. One is Lord and one is not. And the Lord Jesus had to send somebody back into the jail cell and tell John the Baptist, you'll only be blessed if you stay unoffended in me. We'll look at those scriptures as we go through. Hope you remember all of this up to next week. All right. Absalom got offended at David. Absalom got offended at David. All right, what was their relationship? Father-son. Was that their relationship? Oh, no, that was not their relationship. That was not the extent of their relationship. One was father, one was son, one was king, and one was subject. And both were violated. Don't think just because he disagreed with his father and his father's discipline of one of the other boys, that didn't transcend into the fact that David was also his king. He violated both of those relationships in getting offended at his daddy and then going so far as to be convinced that he could do a better job leading the kingdom than David ever could. This is all demonic. It's all been portrayed for us in ages gone by with Lucifer, and it's just lived out in human beings because they don't exercise themselves. So Absalom got offended, subordinate, peer or superior. You see it again. You see it again. All right, Michal. Michal was David's wife. Did she get offended at David? What did she get offended about? His worship. He's dancing before the Lord. She doesn't like it. Now let's see. David is worshiping the Lord and dancing. And David is her... Thank you. You were listening. Husband and king. David was her king. No matter if she's married to him, he's the king. That doesn't make her the king. He's the king. And he's dancing. And she didn't think he should be. So she put her mouth on him and criticized him. Well, I'm sure God would understand because that was his wife. Really. She was cursed for the rest of her days, for the extent of her life, she was cursed. Got offended. What business do I have criticizing someone else's worship? It's none of my business. None of my business whatsoever. Matter of fact, my Bible says in Romans chapter 14, who are you to judge another man's servant? Now, did you hear what that said? Did you catch what that said? Who are you to judge another man's what? So that means you have to be over them. You have to put yourself over top of someone to become offended at them and critique them and criticize them and judge them as doing anything wrong. And she was cursed all of her days. Because she did that. Not to a subordinate, not to a peer, to a superior. Had to criticize him. All right? Did David have opportunity to take offense? Did David have opportunity to become offended at his daddy for not calling him in? Yeah. The prophet came down to their house. 1 Samuel chapter 17. The prophet came down to their 16, excuse me. The prophet came down to their house and was going to anoint the next king of Israel. And Jesse, the father, he called 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You 7 sons of mine, come and stand before the prophet. He forgot number 8. Left number 8 stand out in the field. Left him out with the sheep. He's a kid. He's a runt. He's a teeny bopper, pimple-faced, ready. We don't want to call him in here. And they didn't call him in. And he went all through the 7, and the Lord just told the prophet, nope, it's not this one. I've rejected him. Nope, it's not this one. Nope, it's not this one. Nope, it's not. And the prophet stepped back, looked at Jesse, and said, what's up? Do you have any more boys? Because it's not one of these. And he said, yeah, I've got one more, but he's with the sheep. He said, bring him in. And he brought him in, and the Lord said, this is he. Anoint him. He could have got offended at his daddy. His brothers made fun of him. He could have got offended at the prophet because the prophet left and left him there to care for the sheep instead of taking him off to his bright future in the next level. Left him there. And then there he got sent back out in the sheep. He could have got double offended at his daddy. Take care of the stinky sheep. And then his daddy sent him off to go visit the battle where all of his other brothers got to go while he stayed with the sheep and take them bread and cheese. And he took them bread and cheese. And he went, and they all mocked him. go ahead and take care of your little bit. And he could have got offended at them. He didn't. He slayed Goliath. And then King Saul got angry at him because people were singing his praises more than King Saul's praises. And King Saul got angry at him. Let that anger get into his heart and seethe in his heart until he tried to murder David twice by his own hand. And then he mustered 12,000 troops. And they chased David all over the countryside trying to catch him. And God just helped him and helped him and helped him and helped him. And they never caught him. But he could have got offended. And at any point he would have got offended, he'd have cut off his future. He'd have cut off the blessing of God. But he didn't. You can live your life free of offense, no matter what people try to do to you, no matter what how they treat you, no matter what happens. You do not have to have a feeling of resentment because you've been mistreated. Amen. Or because you were corrected, like Judas was. Okay? Because you didn't get what you wanted. Maybe the boss promoted somebody else, gave them more responsibility than you. Maybe the coach put someone else in the starting lineup instead of you. And now you're offended at the coach. And you don't even want to be around the coach. He's helped you so much. He's helped you all those years. He's poured himself into you. And you don't want to be around him. And pastor called Adam up to the platform and let him help with the service and let him help preach and compared him to that poinsettia down there. Thank you. But he's never called me up there. Now you're offended at Adam. Now you're offended at pastor. Remember what Jesus said? He said, I've got a vineyard and I want people to help in it. And he picked a whole group of people, and they all started at 9 in the morning. And then he came out, and he found a whole another group, and they started them at noon. And then he found a whole another group, and he started them at 3. And then he found there were a few left, and he started them at 5 in the afternoon. And they all came back in, and he paid them all the same. He just pulled it out, and he just started wheeling off, for each of you, for each of you, for each of you. And these people up here got offended. They said, whoa, how could they get the same amount that we're getting over here? And he said, whoa. Didn't you read the employment contract? Do you read? It's not even in the fine print. It says everyone will serve for a penny a day. That was the going rate. That was the going wage. That the wage in that day was a penny a day. And I paid you what I covenanted and agreed with you on. Why are you unhappy with what I did? It's my vineyard, and I promised everyone the same amount. Why are you judging me as having done something wrong when all I did was keep my word? That's what he said. But they feel like they've been mistreated somehow. They weren't offended, the 9 o'clock group. They didn't get offended at the noon group. They didn't get offended at the 3 o'clock group. They didn't even get offended at the 5 o'clock group. They got offended at the boss. Yep. I didn't get treated right. Let me give you the rest of these, and then we're gonna dismiss for tonight. Number two, anger towards, .. Number three, displeased with. These are Bible dictionary, and most of these are found in Webster's dictionary as well. Definitions for what is offense. What does it mean to take offense? It means I have a feeling of resentment, I'm angry towards, I'm displeased with, I'm insulted by. I feel insulted by. I worked hard, they put that person in, that's an insult to me. Okay, insulted by. Number five, hurt feelings. Hurt. Feelings, nothing more than, yeah, emotions. My hurt feelings. Number six, displeased. Oh, I already said that one. Displeased with, I gave number three, disappointed with. Disappointed with. And number seven, strong emotional disagreement. Strong, one's just disagreement with, but one is strong emotional disagreement. Now, all of them are dot, 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 by the way. All of them are continuation. All right, have you got these? Have you got these? A feeling of resentment, anger towards, displeased with, insulted by, hurt feelings, disappointed with, strong emotional disagreement. All of those dot, dot, dots and all of those sentences end the same way, with something done to you. Displeased about something done, feeling of resentment with something done to you, anger toward something done to you, displeased with, insulted by, hurt feelings over, strong emotional disagreement, something. Okay, let me, here, she didn't write it right. She didn't write it right. Are you looking up here? Something done, she didn't write that right. Because this is the way it's written in there. To you. 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 The emphasis in offense is always you. Offense is grounded and rooted in selfishness, self-motivation. I don't feel validated. I don't feel important. I got passed over. I feel insulted. I am displeased. I got my feelings hurt. Selfishness. Selfishness. Now, whoever's on the piano can come up. That helps me remember that that I'm done. That I'm done. I've just got so much. I've got so much. I want you to help me read this one. These are 10 ways to stop being offended. I've got 5 ways to know how you're to be able to tell you are offended. I've got 9 escape hatches to get out of offense. You want to come back next Wednesday?
Yes.
I'm serious. I'm gonna conclude this next Wednesday. I'm not gonna go to 9 o'clock. I'm gonna let you go home. Nine escape hatches to get yourself out of offense. 10 ways to keep from taking everything so hard. That's the subtitle. See it?
Yes.
How not to take offense, and then 5 ways to identify whether you're in offense or not, whether you've taken offense. But I want you to read with me. What does that say right there, number 7?
Overcome.
Yeah, come on, louder.
Overcome.
What?
Self-centeredness.
Overcome self-centeredness. What is it?
It's...
Come on, closer.
I
don't bite.
It's all about me mentality is fertile soil for being frequently offended.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll just read it. I'll just read it. I just made a copy of this. 10 ways to keep yourself from being offended. Number 7 is overcome self-centeredness. It's all about me mentality is fertile soil for being frequently offended.
Thank you for watching The Word of the Lord, a weekly television broadcast of Living Word Christian Church. Living Word Christian Church welcomes you to join us at 2015 Ward Avenue in La Crosse, Wisconsin, Sunday mornings at 8:15 and 10:30, and Wednesday evenings at 7. For more information on Living Word Christian Church, visit us on the web at lwcclax.com.